This is my Ender 5 Pro.
It arrived a couple of days ago, and I have to say, it's a great printer, especially for the price. One of the reasons I went with the slightly more expensive Pro version is that it's equipped with modern trinamic stepper motor drivers, which pretty much eliminate the very characteristic sound of moving steppers, leaving only a nice manageable fan sound. This was important to me, as I don't have the luxury of putting the printer in another room for overnight or multiple day prints. As nice as it is not to have to worry about the sound, the light is a problem. Namely, the LCD backlight. There's no way to turn it off. Let's fix that. Now, when you have a hammer, everything starts to look like a nail, and I think that's why the user Wolfgang Su, over on Thingiverse, designed this 3D printable snap-on cover. I'm not trying to hate on the guy, quite the contrary. Based on the comments, it's a great design. And if you have this problem with your 3D printer, that means you have a 3D printer. But I personally also have the tools to mod the backlight itself, so let's do that instead. I'm just gonna turn off the printer, yank this plug, and unscrew these mounts. Now I'm also gonna take off the metal cover by first removing the encoder knob and then unscrewing those 4 hex bolts, but you don't have to. I just wanted to see the other side of the PCB to make sure there were no elements there, and well, there aren't. Now, we're in luck, because this is an edge-lit LCD, meaning there is only a single line of LEDs here, and a diffuser to make the light uniform all over the screen. This means finding the backlight connection is pretty easy, we just have to look under that edge. And showing you how to find the correct place to do the mod on is why I'm making this video in the first place. I mean, there is an instructable online that just shows you which resistor to desolder, but I was pretty certain there is more than one revision of this board out there with different layouts, and sure enough, this one is different than the one in the instructable. So what's going on here? Well, we have a couple of things on this board. There are the backlight connections, which are of particular interest to us, but apart from that, we can see several chip-on-board ICs, aka the three black blobs, which, judging by the incredible number of vias they are connected to, are driving the LCD matrix itself. These six plastic tabs are what holds the black frame around the LCD and, by extension, the whole LCD assembly together with the board. There's a bell here, which is driven by this transistor here. Had the designer also implemented something like this for the backlight, it could be controlled by software, and there would be no need for this mod. Other than that, we have various auxiliary caps and resistors. My guess is that the big cap here is used for decoupling, and some others are used by the internal charge pumps to generate the higher voltages required to drive the LCD properly. But that's not why we're here. We just want to find the LED resistor. Now, the subcircuit we are trying to locate will literally just be our backlight LED and a resistor in series, as the power draw of the LED is so small there was no need for a more fancy way of driving it. With that being said, the resistor still needs to dissipate some power, so it has to be physically big, or at least bigger than the other ones. That naturally makes R14 our candidate. Looking at its markings, we see 680. 68 times 10 to the 0th power, or 68 ohms. That's in the right ballpark, and an order of magnitude less than other resistors on board. So what are we expecting? Either one of the LED legs will be connected to ground, another one to the resistor, and the other side of the resistor to positive voltage, or the other way around. Let's stick with the first version. Let's get a DMM to test this out. To check continuity with ground, I used one of these exposed pads here as a reference. We can see that the upper electrode is in fact connected to the ground plane. That much we could tell even with our eyes. But as for the lower electrode, it seems to use this plated through hole as a via. From there it connects to the lower side of our suspected resistor, which means the upper side of it is our positive power supply. Now let me just interject for a moment, as I'd like to point out that the shape of the through hole our signal is routed through is the same as the ones the backlight is soldered to. This, in conjunction with the fact that there is a symmetrical through hole on the other side, means that they form an alternative footprint for LCDs with a slightly different backlight pin layout. Anyway, that's all we need to know. Because the SMD pads are prone to lifting, at least when they have relatively significant force applied to them, I won't reuse the 68 ohm SMD resistor and instead replace it with a 1/4 watt axial one. Now for the schematic of the mod, it is literally just adding a switch in series. As for the switch, I checked my parts bin and found this big chungus, this bag of slide switches, and this horrible staple of 1980s Eastern Bloc technology known as an isostat. For obvious reasons, options 1 and 3 are out, so let's unpack the bag. Brushing the push buttons aside, we find 3 slider switches. One is too small, one is too big, and one is just perfect. After a test fit, it's time to let the hot glue gun heat up, and in the meantime desolder the SMD resistor. With an inadequately heated up glue gun, and therefore using tremendous force on the trigger, I glued the switch in place, rather weakly. I think I'll need to fix it up later. Let's cut the axial resistor down to size, freshen the solder on the switch's leads, and solder the resistor in place. A little more snippety snap, some fresh solder here, and it's time to solder our first wire, being very careful not to leave the SMD pad. A snip and a strip later, it's time to solder the other side. Now for the other connection, it's more of the same, just solder one side, trim the wire, strip it, and solder it in place. With the hot glue gun properly heated up this time, it's time to first secure the SMD pad we soldered to, as it's the most probable point of failure, put some glue on the joint next to it, and then cover the whole switch area in hot glue for good measure, making sure not to spill any on the sides of the switch, as it would stop it from moving. This puddle of hot glue also serves as the aforementioned fix for switch adhesion, which I screwed up earlier. As you can see, the switch even spring-backed a little, because the hot glue from earlier melted. So, lacking a clamp, I'll just hold it in with my fingers. Sparing you the reassembly process, let's pan over to my printer's intended home. And does it work? You bet your ass it does. The mod is even pretty stealthy, as you have to look at quite an angle to see it. So that's it, thanks for watching, and see you in, I don't know, less than a year, hopefully?
This is my Ender 5 Pro, a 3D printer so quiet, most people probably don't listen to the steppers. But they should, because it's not just about the pleasures of 3D printing and the importance of FDM. It's also a personal statement about Creality itself.